New topic, year 11, still within the infectious diseases, but now instead of looking at the pathogens, we're going to look at how we actually prevent them. Our last slide talked about our immune system, our last slide from last video. We're going to go into detail about that. What's its role? We can summarize in three words: detect and protect. So the first thing we need to be able to do is talk about the detection, self versus non-self. How does the body know? How does the body actually identify what comes from itself, what is endogenous, what is its own origin, and what is exogenous, what has come from another? Hay fever, asthma, rheumatoid arthritis, diabetes, all have one thing in common. Actually, they have several things in common. One of them is that they are diseases caused by the immune system. Now, none of those diseases are necessarily caused by a pathogen, so why on earth am I talking about them? Well, it's because while hay fever and asthma are hypersensitivity reactions, rheumatoid arthritis and diabetes are autoimmune diseases. Autoimmune diseases are diseases where the immune system attacks your own cells. It does so because they are not able to correctly identify what is self and what is non-self. These two diseases show how critical it is for the immune system to be able to properly identify our own cells, as well as properly identifying pathogens to reduce unnecessary damage. Now, it does so by a variety of different specialized proteins, and these proteins are unique to each individual, and we've done some recent research to see that possibly even unique in identical twins. These are areas, or these are genes, of massive variation, hyper variability. We'll talk about those later. Strongly recommend you read that article there, by the way, on that underlined identical twin section. Really worth reading. So, antigens then, friend or foe? Antigens are particles that are able to bind to certain proteins of the immune system. They can be cell fragments, organelles, membrane fragments, they can be proteins, they could be entire cells or whole viral particles. But the body is constantly surrounded by them. In fact, right now, as you're breathing, you are taking in terrific amounts of antigens. Your body is processing huge volumes of antigens. Well, I mean, compared to each cell, the body is just surrounded by them, flooded with them. And so it needs to be able to scan them efficiently. It needs to be able to categorize them as self or non-self, pathogenic or harmless, and then it needs to respond appropriately. In healthy people, not all antigens produce an immune response. In fact, it's fair to say that the majority don't. But in the conditions mentioned earlier, the diseases mentioned beforehand, and a lot of others, the system fails. It doesn't do its job properly. Now, here we have our example, or here we've got just an example up on the board. Antigen here in red binds to an antigen receptor. Now, here's a bit of a throwback. That looks very familiar, doesn't it? It looks a lot like the molecular recognition system that pathogens use to get into our cells. We're using the same system. This complementary binding is used by both the pathogens and our body. We've flipped it around on them. Sure, you might be able to use the proteins on our cells to attack us. We'll do the same thing. We'll use the proteins that you produce, or the bits of your body, or in fact, your entire cell. And we will identify you based on that, and we will respond. Once it encounters an antigen, the immune cell has two options. It can either engender an immune response, or it cannot. In many cases, the antigen is actually the signal for the immune system to do nothing. Imagine this as an example, and this is a real example. A white blood cell, one of the immune cells, is rolling around the red, the body, rolling in the bloodstream. And it encounters a red blood cell. The red blood cell protein attaches, let's say that's what this is a red blood cell protein. And the antigen receptor binds to the red blood cell protein. And that sends a signal to the cell to say, this is a healthy and happy red blood cell. Leave it alone. And it rolls along and it keeps rolling and then it runs into another one. And it rolls into another one and then eventually it runs into a red blood cell that doesn't have that antigen. And that sends a signal to this immune cell to say, there's something wrong with this. Maybe this red blood cell has a mutation which is leading it towards leukemia. And so the immune cell says, well, I didn't receive the signal. I need an immune response. I'm going to attack this cell, destroy this cell, and I'm going to recruit other of my friends here, other immune cells, and we're going to find these cells and get rid of them. So it's not true to say that antigens are always what's causing the response. Sometimes it's the absence of them that causes the response. So this brings us to this next stage, self-identification. How can we actually identify ourselves? Well, the immune system has evolved to identify self-cells, and this is called self-tolerance, or just more simply, just tolerance. The self-antigens, they're kept from becoming immunogenic. Now there's a difference. There are antigens, and then there are immunogenic antigens. Immunogenic antigens are antigens that cause an immune response that fit into this category. So if you have an immunogenic antigen, you're going to trigger an immune response. That's bad. If you're a red blood cell, because that means the immune system is going to come hunting for you. So what are the sorts of things that that self-antigens have that keep them from being immunogenic? Well, there is epigenetic alteration that recognizes self-antigens. So there are modifications to your genome, epigenetic modifications, histone winding, methylation, that all help this recognition. Cells that are self-sensitized are turned off or inactivated. So cells that are immune cells, that are sensitive, that don't have tolerance, they're turned off or inactivated. Sometimes these intolerant cells are just destroyed. Sometimes they're left alone. Sometimes they remain naive. They persist in the body because they ignore the antigen that they detect. They pick up the antigen, but they don't do anything with it. They fall into this category, no immune response. Which is okay, until it's not. There's another article there underlined in green. I'd strongly recommend that you have a quick read of that. It's a Nature article. For those of you who haven't ever read a Nature article before, they're written in such a way that people can access them quite easily. So if you read it, it's not going to be full of really difficult scientific jargon. It will have some, but it's going to be written in such a way that it's basically a scientific magazine. So I strongly recommend you do read that one. Question here, though. When would it be incredibly helpful for the immune system to recognize and destroy self-antigens? What is a disease? Not necessarily infectious. What is a disease where it'd be helpful to recognize and destroy self-antigens? That's a question we'll talk about in class. All right, our last slide for this video. Non-self-identification. Foe, but only sometimes. All parts of the immune system can detect non-self antigens and, for those that are identified as dangerous, it brings about an immune response, an immunological response. So, in most cases, non-self antigens are immunogenic. The kind of response, what type of immunological response happens, depends largely on which part of the immune system is involved. But it is always aimed at eliminating the pathogen and limiting disease. As soon as the antigen is no longer present, the response should gradually reduce until only a few memory cells remain. Now, there's a term we're going to come back to. And this is a critical thing. Some diseases are actually caused not by the pathogen themselves, but by the over-exuberant response of the immune system. The body isn't able to scale down the response once the pathogen has been eliminated. And it might cause physical damage, you might destroy muscle tissues, or it could just be that you just exhaust the body. It might just be that you just end up getting run down. Here we go. Another question. In what situation is it best for the body to ignore non-self antigens? Small hint for one potential reason. The women in the room are more likely to run into it than the men. But again, another one that we'll discuss later. It's our last video for this, last slide for this video. So we'll come back to a few of those questions in class. Otherwise, thank you, Year 11.